by faith and not by sight, no gracious words we hear from him who spoke as none has spoke, but we believe him near. He may not touch his hands and side, but follow where he trod. But in his promise we rejoice and cry, my Lord and God. Help then, O Lord, our unbelief, and may our faith abound to call on you when you are near and seek where you are found.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Well, as we gather together on this kind of chilly evening, we come together to celebrate the 27th Sunday of Ordinary Time. As always, a special welcome to anyone visiting us or anyone who's come back for the first time. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery.
Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. Thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father. The sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and the desires of those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded it, cleared it of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it he built a watchtower and hewed out a wine press. Then he looked for the crops of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done? Why, when I looked for the crops of grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? Now, I will let you know what I mean to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing, break through its wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but he sees bloodshed, for justice, but hark the outcry, the word of the Lord.
Shall forsake you again. Give us life that we may call upon your name. O Lord God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine forth and we shall be saved. The vineyard of the Lord is the
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Hear another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to the tenants and went on a journey. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to obtain his produce. But the tenants seized the servants, and one they beat, another they killed, and a third they stoned. Again, he sent other servants, more numerous than the first ones, but they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, thinking, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to one another, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and acquire his inheritance.' They seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. What will the owner of the vineyard do to those tenants when he comes?" They answered him, "He will put those wretched men to a wretched death and lease his vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at proper times." Jesus said to them, Did you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes.' Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will produce its fruit." The Gospel of the Lord.
I think all too often we blame God when things don't go the way we want them to go. We blame God for the bad things that happen in our lives. More than once when I've been in the confessional, somebody's come in to confess, "Father, I am angry with God," or, "I've been angry with God." And usually it has to do with, you know, a relationship has fallen apart, they've lost a job, maybe a loved one's sick, or maybe somebody has died. And listen, there's times in my life I've said, God, if this is how you treat your friends, how do you treat your enemies? Don't get me wrong. But why do we have this tendency to blame God when bad things happen in our lives? Why do we do that? You know, I think if we're humble enough and if we're honest enough with ourselves, we'll ask a better question. Why do good things happen in our lives? Why is there good in the world at all? And where does that goodness come from? Do we ever ask that question? Jesus, why do bad things happen? Not why do good things happen, and where do they come from? In our first reading today, and in our gospel reading today, we have this image of a vineyard. And you know, a vineyard takes a lot of work. It's a lot of money, a lot of resources, a lot of hard work and energy that goes into creating a vineyard. And once you've created it, there's even more work getting it to the point where it's mature enough to produce abundant and good fruit. But God gives us everything we need in that vineyard. God gives that vineyard. He gives it the air. He gives it sunlight, water, soil. In our gospel reading, we even hear how he puts a protective wall around it and puts a guard tower there to protect it as well. In some sense, our soul to God is a vineyard. It's a vineyard of virtue. And God gives us everything we need as well to bear good fruit. First of all, he gives us life. We have to have that before we can have anything else. He gives us life. And then he gives us talent and opportunities and family and faith and the sacraments. He gives us knowledge. He gives us a conscience. And he gives us the church to guide us in difficult times and in challenging times. I can't think of any good thing that does not owe its origin and existence to God. I don't think there's any good thing we can point to that doesn't owe its origin and its existence to God. I think one of the greatest examples of God's goodness to us is God's mercy and God's patience. And that talks about that in some sense in our gospel reading today, these tenants that God sends out to take care of the vineyard. All he asks is some fruit. Bear some fruit and give me some of that fruit. He asks them to do what's right. When they don't do what's right, what happens? He gives them another chance. He sends another group and another group and another group. And finally, he sends his son to them. How patient he is. How patient he is. In justice, he could have kicked him out right away. You didn't do what you're supposed to do. You're done. Get out of here. But he doesn't do that. He is so patient with our sinfulness and our selfishness. He is so patient with our sinfulness and our selfishness. He gives us so many chances, many more chances than we deserve. And oftentimes, he gives us patience and we are not patient with ourselves. I think God's boundless mercy is the best evidence of his immense goodness. His boundless mercy is the best evidence of his immense goodness. One of my favorite all-time religious movies is the movie The Passion of the Christ. I think most of you probably have seen The Passion of the Christ before. It was produced and directed by Mel Gibson. And when that movie came out, he got a lot of flack, a lot of criticism for a variety of different reasons. And one of the things they criticized was the way he took artistic license with the Gospels. But I think the way that he did that, I think was brilliant. Because I think he really brings out the amazingness of God's mercy and God's goodness. And one of the scenes I was thinking about in particular is the scene about the good thief. Because the Gospels don't really bring out why he repented. There's nothing in there that really says why that good thief repented. But Mel Gibson kind of brings a little storyline that kind of brings to why he may have done that. Part of it is they're all there at the beginning when they're carrying the cross, and this good thief is kind of watching what Jesus is doing and how he's reacting. In the midst of this, Jesus is patient. He's determined. There's no anger. There's no guile in him. He's actually docile in the midst of all of that. And the thing, I think, that opens this thief's heart when Jesus forgives those who are about to kill him, those who are persecuting him, I think that's the thing that really opened his heart up to God's grace. And it's that line, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. That unimaginable act of forgiveness, I think, brings this thief to conversion. He comes to a realization at that point that God is good and that God's mercy is there, no matter how bad he is, right up to that last moment. God's going to give him mercy. And Jesus, of course, affirms him in that. This criminalist, this terrible sinner, he tells him, it's okay. God's grace is enough. God's grace is there for you. I think Mel Gibson did a masterful job of showing us God's mercy and God's goodness. One of the things that they criticized him about is that very line that he uses. Because he uses the line, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. He doesn't use it just once. He uses it twice. He uses it when he's being nailed to the cross. He uses it when he's hanging on the cross. And scripture scholars are quick to point out, well, you know, Mel, Jesus only says that one time in the Gospels. Why do you get this too? And you know what his response was? I think Jesus was saying that the whole time. I think he was forgiving them the whole time they're leading him along the cross and nailing him to the cross and hanging him there. That's God's boundless mercy and God's infinite goodness. There's something we find in the Protestant world, and it's kind of, to me it's a little corny, but it kind of gets the point across that I'm talking about today. Some of you have probably heard it. The preacher will get up and he'll say, God is good. And all the people say, all the time. And then the preacher says, all the time. And the people say, God is good. So it's a little bit corny, but doesn't it hit home the message I'm trying to make today? That God is indeed good. And not only is he good, he's good all the time. And immensely good. Let us pray this week. We come to know and experience this boundless mercy and this boundless goodness. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in God's infinite mercy and goodness, we turn to him with our needs and the needs of our world.
For Pope Francis and all church leaders who show us how to cultivate the church, a fruitful harvest for the Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, may God heal our wounds, fill us with his grace and hope, so we may live productive and fruitful lives. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a growing respect for the dignity of each and every human life, especially those at life's margins, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are awaiting surgery, seriously ill, or those who suffer in any way, may they receive the healing power of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have gone before us in death, for Brian Call, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the prayers in the prayer intention book, and for the prayers we hold in the silence of our hearts. we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to the spread of the coronavirus, and for healing for all those afflicted, and the repose of the souls of those who have died, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, these are our prayers. Grant them according to your will, through the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus, who is Lord forever and ever.
Church of Christ in every age, beset by change, but spirit-led, must claim and test its heritage, and keep on rising from the dead. Across the world, across the street, the victims of injustice cry, a shelter and for bread to eat, and never live until they die.
Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands and through the sacred mysteries which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world and all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so of all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. And make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving his holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Luke, and with all the saints. On whose constant intercession, your presence, we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Edward, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, and your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you in their passing from this life, give kind events to our kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, the whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's been informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With a simple vow, let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For our visitors, as we come forward this evening for Holy Communion, I invite you to go out to the outsides of the pews toward the stained glass windows. Work your way up the side aisles. You will see red lines on the floor for our social distancing. Once you've received, we invite you to go back up the center aisle, being conscious to keep social distance. If you have hand sanitizer in the pews, please use it. If you do not, please be sure to stop at the side tables for the hand sanitizer. And of course, on the way out in the mass, we ask you to come forward, dropping your bulletins to the blue bins, and also you can put your collection in the baskets.
Servant, he calls to me. will choose Christ. I will choose love. I choose to serve. I give my heart. I give my life. I give my all to you. Christ, my teacher and healer, teach my heart and heal my soul. And as I walk this road with you, teach me to love. I will choose Christ. I will choose love. I choose to serve. I give my heart. I give my life. I give my all to you. As I look upon your must I die with you, and with the death of my own desires, I'll rise with you. I will choose Christ. I will choose love. I choose to serve.
Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed to what we consume through Christ our Lord. Some of you may have received an email purportedly from me this past week. It is absolutely a phishing scam. I would never send you an email saying, hey, I need something, I need a favor. I would never ask you for a gift card through an email. And by the way, they're using a Gmail account. The only only time I'll ever send you an email, my official St. Luke one is frkevin@stlakewood.org. It's the only time you'll receive one, or through our Flock Note. And by the way, if you're not on Flock Note, get on Flock Note, because when this happens, and it's going to happen again, this is the third time already now, we send out a notice that the phishing scam is going around again. Our IT, our computer system, our internet is perfectly secure. It's not that. These scammers build a kind of a database of a particular organization, and they just build every person they can put into there, and they send out these emails. There's nothing more we can really do about it other than warn you and tell you it's not for me. I'm not asking for favors or for money or gift cards over an email. I promise you that. Speaking of Flock Note, those of you who have Flock Note, you should have received a letter that the bishop asked all the pastors to pass on to the parishioners. If you did not receive it in the Flock Note, we passed it out in the bulletins today. Obviously, you don't have to put that in a recycle bin. If you want to take it home and take some time to read that, we certainly encourage you to do that. Oh, one more thing. Father Joe Workman, some of you may know Father Workman. He is the pastor of St. James and St. Clements. I ask for your prayers for him. He has announced to his parish today that he has stage 3 rectal cancer. So he's undergoing treatment. The prognosis looks pretty good. But please say some prayers for Father Workman. Certainly he has 2 parishes on top of all of that. So some prayers for Father Workman this week. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Rejoice, the Lord is King. Rejoice, give thanks and sing and triumph.